Everyone, I have the pleasure of continuing our James series. I will not be ploughing through the whole of James chapter 4, because as you'll see, there's quite a lot to it. And seeing as the last time we did a book of the Bible and I was ploughing through the entire chapter, we had a mammoth hour-long preaching session, which I won't make you all endure again. So, James chapter 4, and this was beautifully titled, Things to Avoid. I always think it's quite nice, isn't it? Don't you just love that happy topic of things to avoid? But quite relevant, and there's an awful lot in here that, ironically, I don't think Mum or Sandra, who both touched on things that are going to come up in my sermon, have any idea what was coming up, unless Mum cheated and read ahead in James chapter 4. But yeah, they almost stole chunks of my sermon, but they just about dodged it, so that was good. So the book of James contains so much practical instruction, as you probably realise from what Todd's been teaching on the last few weeks, of how Christians should live their lives. It's a really practical book. That's one of the things I love most about James. And he wrote to believers who seem to have quite a few problems with their behaviour. Not that any of us can possibly identify with that, right? The one he addresses at the beginning of chapter 4 generally has to do with their desire to get things. Now, if anyone is obsessed with Temu, as I am, and apparently I've now got most of my colleagues into, nobody? If you don't know what I'm talking about, then don't worry. Please don't Google it. You will become obsessed too. It's a very dangerous time sap. Anyway, so in chapter 3 last week, the author of the book of James began dealing with the problem of quarrelling and backbiting within the church. And the immediate issue seems to have been people were competing with each other for position within the church. And they were using their tongues to tear one another down. Having spoken about the tongue's evil and the power of wisdom to counteract it, James turns in chapter 4 to consider the quarrels themselves and like the causes of them. In a brilliant explanation of human nature, fallen as it is, he shows us that quarrels are the result of unfulfilled, prideful desires warring within us. And then he encourages his readers to repent of their pride. So that's a little bit of an overview of what we're going to be diving into this morning. So James chapter 4 verses 1 to 3 says this. What is the source of quarrels and conflicts among you? Is not the source your pleasures that wage war in your members? You lust and do not have, so you commit murder. You are envious and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask with wrong motives so that you may spend it on your pleasures. Anyone just a tiny bit convicted? Last time I checked, I don't think anyone in here has murdered anybody because they didn't get what they wanted. Or did we? So the passage reveals the following inappropriate actions and attitudes. First of all, the people wanted a lot. Never guilty of wanting a lot, right? And this was causing them to fight and quarrel among themselves. Presumably they were frustrated with each other as they couldn't get what they wanted. Anybody? Never get frustrated when I don't get what I want. Sometimes I look at myself and think, am I just tantruming like a little child? Oh yeah, kind of. That was really bad. So number two, the inability to get what they wanted had driven some of them to commit murder. Maybe they were literally murdering each other. I mean, we don't actually know what was going on in the book this time. But more likely, they were thinking and doing hateful things that Jesus said basically amounts to no better than murder. Now, again, I'm not sure we're all walking around doing or saying hateful things, but, you know, maybe we are. There are other bits of the Bible that say that thoughts are as bad as actions. So maybe sometimes it is. Number three, they coveted, but were unable to get what they wanted. And coveted is when you look at something that somebody else has and you want it. Anybody? Mum always jokes, she's like, I'm so bad at coveting. Usually people's gardens and houses. I'm sure she won't mind me out, but it's so true, it is. Does anybody, especially, or an arga, that's it, a house with an arga, that's what she wants. And you know, it can be, it's funny, it's a joke, but there are times, and especially in this world of social media and comparison, when it's very easy to look at someone else's life that you see perceived, and it's only perception, because nobody's really posting the nasty stuff. People like all these beautiful posts going, yeah, my life's really messy too. And you're like, is it really though? Are you really a hot mess? Or are you just pretending that you're a hot mess by like sculpting your house so it looks a little bit untidy? But in this world of comparison, it can be very easy to look at somebody else's existence and life that you perceive and go, you know what? I'm a little bit jealous that my life doesn't look like that. Is that just me? No. Like, thanks, everyone. Somebody please. But it is that moment where no one's deliberately going, like, I didn't wake up in the morning and go, today I'm going to cover, what a great idea. No, of course you do. But you have those little thoughts, those little moments where you're like, I wish my life was like that. Why is my life not like that? Right? And that is equal to coveting, because you're looking at that and then you kind of want it. And then if that leads to quarrels and fights, even if it's quarrels and fights with your spouse because you're feeling dissatisfied with your life, it breeds that kind of, just that bad feeling, that ick. And then number four, they refused to pray, or if they did pray, they did so out of selfish motives. Does this seem familiar? Unfortunately, the group of people to whom James writes looks like many people today. They're Christians who are out to further their own agenda to get what they want by any means possible. And when they're frustrated and aimed, they lash out at each other. James says there's a better way. Instead of coveting, quarrelling, fighting, and even killing, Christians need to simply ask God for what they want. And one reason that we don't have what we want is because we haven't asked. And then there's this big theological debate that goes around, is whether God actually ever changes his mind in response to our prayers. Some would say that God never changes his mind and that he'll always do what he planned to do in the first place. And then other people say the complete opposite, that God cannot or will not do anything unless we ask. I like to think it's somewhere in the happy medium in the middle. But we do have to trust God with his decision. There's many times in the Bible it asks us to pray. It asks us to ask him. And there's many times we see that no matter what people ask for, God does what God does. James 4 doesn't really address that big theological issue, is does prayer change God's mind? It simply says that if there's something we want, we need to ask God for it instead of resorting to ungodly means to get it. And it stands to reason that some things we won't get unless we ask for them, but if we ask, we will receive them. So if there's something we want, we need to ask, just like we did this morning. Don't give up on asking. Of course, James's statement says that you do not have because you do not ask. But then it goes on to say, it doesn't mean we're definitely going to get everything we ask for. A father, for example, might tell his child, don't steal anything from the tool shed. If you want something, just ask. But then if the child goes, can I have a chainsaw? The dad's going to go, yeah, for safety reasons, it's probably not a wise idea. I'm not going to give that to you. Likewise, when we ask God for something, he reserves the right to do what's best for us, which is not always the same as giving us what we would like. And that's the problem. That's the wrestling point for us, isn't it? But I think the key here is, don't try and judge whether or not God's going to do it. Ask and let God decide. We spend so long, if you're anything like me, you spend so long going, well, is this even right to even ask for it? That before I've thought about it, I've gone round and round in circles and taught myself out of even asking. Because I've decided that that's not something God wants to do or give or in that moment. Some things it's super easy, you go, well, I'm just going to pray about that. There's been something this week, I literally had a conversation with Todd, turned into a little bit of a heated conversation, I'm not going to lie, because I said, I think we need to contend for this. And Todd was like, well, is that the right thing to contend for? And I was like, who is our structure? This is before I knew what I was preaching on, by the way. And then I sat down and I'm like, oh, really, God, you are having a laugh. And the first beginning of James 4 is exactly the conversation that Todd and I had earlier this week. Don't you just love it when God does those moments and you feel like so convicted? But actually, it brought me a lot of clarity. So in verse 3, it brings up a situation where God may not grant our requests.
says, "What?" I don't know if you can read that. It says, "When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives." So while it's better to ask for God for things than to scheme or fight and try to get them at the expense of other people, there are some requests that are still selfish at their root, and these God will deny. The bottom line is, when you want something, you need to ask him for it and let him decide what's best for you. So easy, right? Just like that. There are some times when God may say no because we ask with the wrong motives, and there may be some times that he says yes because he wants us to have what we ask for. But his yes doesn't necessarily mean that the object of our desire will arrive on a silver platter. How he answers the prayers is still up to him. And receiving what we ask for may mean God gives us the ability to save money to buy what we want. The answer to our prayer does not rule out a third party involvement. Our prayer is our signal that we have abandoned trying to get things our own way, and instead that we're deferring to God's judgment about what we get and how we get it. And that's the crucial key. It's deferring to God. It's not the not asking. Knowing what God wants to give us is infinitely more valuable and good for us than what we can dream up on our own. And therefore we pray in confidence and faith. So continue to ask, but defer the choice to God. If there's something you want and you need to ask God for it, many times you have not because you ask not. But there's no guarantee that you'll get it, but it is the best possible chance you have. And prayer will keep you within God's will. When you've submitted your will to his, you will be happy with what he gives you, whether or not you get what you originally asked for. Because that's where, when we align our desire with his will and his desire for us, then we're content with the outcome. And that's part of what the asking, the praying's for. So the conversation I had with Todd, I have slightly changed my prayer now. I have a very specific prayer and I have a more general prayer as part of it. And it's all under some greater topic, and I'm deliberately being quite ambiguous. I'm still asking because I believe God told me to contend for it. But I'm saying, God, if this is your will, if this is what you want for us, if this is what is right, and I submit under your will. Is it easy? Nope. I'm in a daily struggle with it? Yep. Did I nearly have a panic attack about the issue earlier this week? Absolutely. But it's about trusting that God knows what's best. And God will answer. It just might not be in the way that we hope or think that we need, but he knows what's best. Moving on to verses 4. Now the class, this is a brilliant start, isn't it, when it starts with, "You adulteresses!" Whoa, okay. And one of the versions actually says, "You adulterers and adulteresses," so it's not just targeted to women, if anybody likes to get on that fence. "Do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility toward God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the scripture speaks with no purpose? He jealously desires the spirit which he has made to dwell in us." So James, after observing the rampant worldliness in the lives of his readers, he launches into a warning. And with this very harsh assessment, "You adulterous people," the ESV puts it, "do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility or enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God." So hostility or enmity is another word for that. You might have heard that word used in the same context. Is animosity. It's the state of being actively opposed to someone. A common biblical metaphor for spiritual unfaithfulness in our relationship with God is adultery. Nowhere is this imagery more evident than in the book of Hosea. "And while God showed unfailing love to Israel, they responded with faithlessness, immorality, and idolatry." Scripture often depicts God as the husband of his people and the believers as his bride. So when James calls his readers adulteresses, the implication is clear. To the God who has loved his people unsparingly and relentlessly, what could be more painful than their heartless betrayal? James calls out a challenge to people who have turned their hearts away from God and fallen in love with the world. When he speaks of the world, he means the world system or the world order, consisting of people whose beliefs, values, and morals are in direct opposition and rebellion to God's. The goals and objectives of the world are in direct contrast to his commands, and to cling to the world, so if we choose to cling to that, then we're choosing hostility and enmity to God. James warns believers not to cultivate a lifestyle that resembles a friendship with the world. We must never pursue the ideals, morals, goals, or purposes of the world, but instead seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So what does friendship with the world look like? Because that's a pretty big threat. It's a pretty big warning, and we're like, hold on a minute, aren't we all in the world? How do we know we're not like dancing on the edge? How can we be sure that we're not setting ourselves up to be enemies of God? One clear indication we have for friends of the world is our behaviour, and that's exactly why James was writing this at the time. Clearly, the behaviour of Christians was displaying, or at least some of them, was displaying that they were siding with the world. Are we acting like the people of the world? Do we quarrel, covet, and fight? Do we harbour bitter envy and selfish ambition? Do we boast and deny the truth? Do we find disorder in every evil practice in our lives? Or instead, do we display deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom? Are we peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and fruit, impartial and sincere? Friendship with the world rubs off on our character, and we probably find ourselves displaying all of the things on the list and more at all different times, probably all of them in one day, or maybe even in a couple of hours. But our aim as we cultivate our relationship with God is that we leave behind our old sinful ways. It doesn't mean that you're never going to do those things and you're always going to do all the good stuff. It's about doing less of the bad stuff, or realizing that you've done the bad stuff quicker and repenting about it, and then trying to do more of the good stuff. Pursuing friendship with the world puts us at odds with God and in danger of forfeiting our souls, which is what it says in Mark chapter 8. On the other hand, if we seek an intimate friendship with Jesus by giving up our own way, our own desires, by taking up our cross and following him, we gain everything we need in this life and for the one to come. If we try to hang on to the worldly way of life, Jesus said, we'll end up losing everything. But if we give up our lives and to cultivate a friendship with Christ for the sake of the gospel, then we gain salvation and everlasting life with him. We see a lot of this dallying sort of in the world right now. And we've been seeing it, I mean, clearly, this is not a new concept. James saw it. We've seen it through generations. We've seen a lot of seeming compromise in the church as saying, well, we need to do what the world's saying because this is the right thing to do. When really it's not. We need to stay true to the course that Jesus and God set through his word. He's very clear. And we can't say, well, this is what the world's saying, so this is the way we should go. The world should not be the one that is steering the course of the church. It's very clear. Culture does not determine the way of the church. It never has, and it never should. God is the one who steers the culture of the church. And he said it very clearly in his word. Even if we believe that God never spoke again, he has set everything we need to know in his word. And he does continue to speak today. I wholeheartedly believe that, and I have experienced it. and he affirms everything he said in his word. True followers of Christ can't be faithful to God at the same time as loving the world. In 1 John 2, you might remember it said, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever." The Christian life is characterized by submission to the will of God. Friendship with the world and obedience to God are irreconcilable. Do you want the but? But, don't you love when there's a but? In words, obviously. "But he gives greater grace. Therefore it said, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble." I will come back to the "but he gives greater grace." I'm not going to just leave it there. We're just going to pause it for a moment. Pride is celebrated in our world. How true a statement is that right now? People proudly flaunt their accomplishments, possessions, or qualities they deem admirable in expectation of praise. Yet selfish pride is a hindrance to salvation and to fruitful relationship with God and others. James warns us about this self-focused pride when he writes, "God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." In warning against pride and promoting humility, James quotes the Septuagint. It's a nice word to say there. I was like, "How'd you say that word, Todd?" And I've literally wrote it down. Septuagint. I'm never going to say that right. The Septuagint is the oldest Greek translation of the Old Testament. I'd heard of it, could I for the life of me remember what it was, so I asked my history buff, aka Todd. I was like, "Todd, what is the Septuagint? Or what is that word I can't say?" So James quotes this, so the oldest Greek translation of the Old Testament, and he did it deliberately because all of the listeners would have known what that was. So we nowadays like, "What? What's that?" They would have known immediately. And in Proverbs 3:34, he quotes it. Of course, James is not referring to pride as a satisfaction of a job well done, or the kind of pride one expresses over the accomplishment of loved ones. He's referring to the kind of pride that stems from self-righteousness or conceit. God opposes the proud because pride is sinful and a hindrance to seeking him. Those who insist on elevating themselves and refusing to trust God as sovereign, good, and trustworthy will find their way opposed to God. And so similar when we were talking about the asking God, if pride is the source of why we're asking, guess what? God's going to oppose it. It's about the source. It's a pride is a perfect example of when we're not going to have something granted to us because we're asking it out of the wrong motives. The supremacy of God and the fact that we can do nothing to inherit eternal life apart from Christ is a stumbling block to prideful people. God will oppose those attempting to be the God of their own lives. So again, if our prayer and our asking means we're trying to be God of our own lives, anybody? No? Anybody ever try and take control? Just me? Everyone's always like, it's a lot of like looking at the ground a little bit awkward. I'm glad I'm not alone. Pride refuses to bend the knee to God or repent of sin, and it keeps so many people from salvation. In contrast to God's opposition to the proud is God's grace to the humble. Those who humble themselves find God's favour. In Psalm 138, verse 6, it says this, "Though the Lord is great, he cares for the humble." God shows his favour to those with a right view, a humble view of themselves, and he promises them restoration. In Isaiah 57, it says this, "I live in a high and holy place, but also with the one who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly, and to revive the heart of the contrite. Note that humility in this passage is related to contrition or repentance. And so repentance here is key. Pride can also hinder our relationship with God and others, even after we're saved. In this letter, James addresses an issue among the believers, namely their quarrels and strifes with one another. I'm sure pride had a part to play, massively. And even now, when quarrels and issues break out, pride is often the source. It's not the only one, by any means, but it is often the source, especially among churches, especially among Christians. The source of their issue was selfish pride, because it negatively affects our relationships, because it inflates our view of self and deflates our view of God and others. And that's what pride is. So let's not miss that tiny but very powerful statement at the beginning of the verse. Exalting ourselves pushes God out of his rightful place in our lives, and he will humble us because the Lord disciplines the ones he loves. And that's from Hebrews chapter 12. As we humble ourselves, he gives a greater grace. God gives us grace that is sufficient to meet every need we have and every sin we face. I'm going to say that again. He gives us grace that is sufficient to meet every need we have and every sin we face, if we're humble enough to receive it. And now a verse that we have probably heard more times than we can count, of chapter 4, verse 7. Submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. To resist means to withstand, to strive against, or to oppose in some manner. Resistance can be a defensive manoeuvre on our part, such as resisting or withstanding the temptation to sin, or it can be an action we use when we use the offensive weapon of the full armour of God, which is listed obviously in Ephesians chapter 6. The sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, is one of the most effective tools that we have in the armour of God. Using the scriptures to expose Satan's lies and temptations is the most effective way to strive against his temptations and to defeat them. But we have to read the whole verse. Submit yourself then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Resisting the devil must be accompanied by submitting to God. A disobedient or unsubmissive believer will not see victory. Now, that doesn't mean if you have a moment of disobedience, the enemy's got full power. This is not something to be terrified of. This is equipping us. This is giving us the tools we need. If you find the enemy coming against you, your first position should be, is there anything in my life where I'm being disobedient? Ask God to show you. If the answer to that is no, then move on. See what I mean? It's like, it's not this, oh my goodness, I made one big mistake or one tiny mistake and the enemy's got full control of my life. The enemy never has full control of my life. Ever. James exhorts his readers to submit to God and thereby resist the devil. James even adds that submitting to God and resisting the devil will cause the devil to flee. By focusing less on ourselves and on fulfilling the desires of our flesh, by turning away from the friendship and the God-opposing world system or culture, and by resisting the devil, the Christian can overcome his three greatest opponents. And these are the opponents that Paul mentions in Ephesians 2:1-3. This isn't Ephesians 2:1-3, by the way, just in case you're thinking it is. James outlines in this context how we have three enemies who hinder us from walking as God designed. Our own flesh, the corrupt world system, and the devil. Paul recognises these same three adversaries. When we were dead to our trespasses in sin, We walked according to the course of his world, according to the prince of the power of the air, and in the lusts of our flesh. And in this condition, we were enemies of God and even children of wrath. And that's from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. So verse 8, draw near to God, and I had to split this in two halves. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. If we're moving towards God, he moves closer to us. While his spirit already lives within those who believe in him, it's evident that we can walk according to the world, the devil, and the flesh. But if on the other hand, we're being filled and controlled by his spirit, then he bears fruit in us. Paul puts it this way in Colossians chapter 3, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. As we focus less on ourselves and more on him, we can be more submissive to him. This seems to be the idea behind what it means to draw near to God and he will draw near to you. As we align our priorities and our desires and our thoughts and our behaviours with what he prescribes, we find that we're walking with him. Can anyone attest to that? The more we focus on God, the more we're in line with him. The more we pray to him about things, the more we ask him about things, the more we are aligned with his will for us. We notice that our priorities change. And it doesn't mean you don't have a moment where you're like, God, that's terrible, help! You know, like, which is fine. You can have all of those moments. This isn't the only way you can pray. But it's about choosing to align ourselves more with how God thinks and behaves and how he is. And we can find out all of the things. Well, how do I know what that is? It's all in his word. The more familiar we become with his word, the more it is in us. And then we become more like him and we pray more like him and our attitude changes and becomes more like him. As we align our priorities, our desires, our thoughts and behaviour with what he prescribes, we are walking with him. And Jesus talked about this in John chapter 15, when he told the disciples they should abide in him. And Todd's talked about this a lot, where we abide in God means we're dwelling with him. We are connected to him. While God has provided so many details about how to walk with him throughout the whole of the Bible, James put things succinctly when he encourages his readers to draw near to God and he will draw near to you. It's that simple. And it's easy to get lost in all these big theological details, as there are so many, and they're all so important and useful. But it's also good for us to see the simplicity of what God is asking us to do. He's asking for a single, quiet fellowship with him. Do you remember when he said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light? Matthew 11. God isn't trying to complicate things for us. He hasn't made walking with him a burden. He reminds us that we need to draw near to him and he will draw near to us. It is that simple. And you'll see now why I split that verse in two. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Hold on a minute. That was a pivot. Be miserable. This is brilliant. Be miserable and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy into gloom. Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord and he will exalt you.
When there's music on.
Okay, I read this the first time. I was like, whoa, 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 wait a minute, what? I reread it about three times and I'm like, no, it does say be miserable and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to gloom. I'm like, hold on, isn't that the complete opposite of what we always sing and what we read in another bit of the Bible? Wait. Okay. Let's start with the cleansing bit, breaking it down. James uses the phrase, cleanse your hands, which to us you're like, okay, wash your hands. What is this, like a COVID test or something? Like, wash your hands, everyone. But again, in the time that he was speaking, it's the language that ancient Jewish ceremonial rituals of worship were very familiar. In order to go into the temple, had to cleanse yourself. You had to be ready. You had to read any part of the beginning of the Old Testament before you realised there was an awful lot of rituals they had to do before they could even set foot in the building. We didn't even require you to shower. I mean, it's quite nice if everyone smells okay, but you know, you can come in with whatever you want around here, it's fine. But even to go into the building, they had to cleanse themselves. Whenever the priest entered the wilderness tabernacle, or later, the sanctuary, and they approached the altar to minister to the Lord, they were required to cleanse their hands and feet with water from the bronze basin. And that's in Exodus chapter 30, it says, they shall wash their hands and their feet so that they may not die. That's how serious it was. It shall be statute forever to them, even to him and his offspring throughout their generations. It was a mandate. You had to do it or you would perish because they were too unclean to come before God. James may have also had these words from King David in mind. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord, who may stand in its holy place, the one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. That's from Psalm 24. James's charge to cleanse your hands focus more on people's worldly actions and outward deeds. God has issued a similar order through the prophet Isaiah. Wash yourselves, cleanse yourselves, remove your evil deeds from my sight. Stop doing evil. Boom. Love that. Isaiah chapter 1. We get our hands dirty when we play in the world's sandpit. We cleanse our hands by removing them from sinful pursuits and moral compromises and then seeking God's forgiveness. Because now, because of Jesus, there is a way. We are not going to die if we come before God unclean, because Jesus has made us clean. He has made us right. We purify our hearts through the inward renewal of our mind and spirit. In Romans 12, 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul taught believers to give their bodies to God, including their hands. Says, let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. James called the people double-minded because they continued to grasp tightly to the world while claiming to love and worship God. Their hearts were divided between the world and God's kingdom. They were pretending to serve God while their hearts were still devoted to the things of the world. The only solution for this dangerously divided and lukewarm existence is to repent and to submit to God by making a fresh commitment to Jesus Christ. So that's why this is so doom and gloom, because it's very serious. We cannot live in both worlds. We can physically, but we certainly can't spiritually. So how can the rebellious Christians remedy their perilous condition? James saw that it was time for people to tear down the walls of denial and get honest with themselves before God. He encouraged them to draw near to God in genuine repentance by experiencing that gut-wrenching sorrow for their sins. And in the New Living Translation, it puts this verse like this. Let there be tears for what you have done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up in honour. And it doesn't say we live in that place. So the scripture says, let our, you know, mourning be turned into dancing. That's the next step. But we have to face our sin and we have to repent of our sin and we have to feel the pain and the sadness and the separation that can create between us and God. We have to have a moment where we acknowledge the gravity of it, but then we have to move on. We repent and we move forward. And then you think, well, that takes a pivot to humble yourself in the presence of the Lord and he will exalt you. You're like, how can we go from like basically beating ourselves with reeds to now humbling ourselves in the presence of the Lord? This is one of the greatest kingdom paradoxes. Jesus taught that anyone who truly humbles himself before the Lord will be exalted. And Peter affirms it in 1 Peter 5, verse 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Sure. Humility is literally lowliness of mind. Not lowliness, that's not a word. I found this great quote, and I was like, I know who said that? You know, you're like, I know this quote, who said it? And then I found it was C.S. Lewis. Humility is not thinking less of ourselves, but thinking of ourselves less. Now, we've talked a lot here about humility and false humility, because often we get mixed up with, if I just think I'm this terrible, terrible human being, then I'm in a better position. And you could get caught up in that previous verse and think, you see, it says, I've got to live in a place of misery and doom and gloom and sadness, because that's what God says. It's in his word, you see. That's why we have to read things in context. We're reading the whole thing. There is a moment where we have to face those things and realize the gravity of it. It is not a light, sin is not a light thing, but it is a very momentary thing because of Jesus. Jesus has made a path for us. He has made a way forward. So humility is not thinking less of ourselves and thinking of ourselves less. It is understanding ourselves properly in light of who God is and who we are and living accordingly. Now, we spent a lot of time, I think it was the beginning of this year, looking at what God says about us. Because we realised that actually this is a big stronghold over the UK specifically. And not that it doesn't happen in other places, it happens a lot, but we see it a lot over the UK. Where how people deal with it is to think, well, I'm just this terrible, terrible person who's no good, and I'm going to live in that state. But we are missing the point of the gospel. We are missing so much of what God has for us if we live in that place. So humility is understanding ourselves properly in light of who God is and what he says about us. God is the creator and sustainer of the universe. We are not. There's a lot of things we are not. The humble person recognizes that all he has is a gift from God. When we humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord, our hearts continually seek after God, even when we sin. And that's really crucial. It's about having that moment where we humble ourselves. When we do things wrong, then we continue to move forward with him. We continue forward. We confess our pride and our faults to God and allow him to transform us into Christ's likeness. We are in process. This is a journey. This is a not, here I am in my terrible state. Oh good, now I've made it. If only it were that easy, right? No, we are all in process. When we make a mistake, we come to God as soon as possible in repentance. As soon as we feel that conviction, come to God in repentance. Feel the deep sorrow for our mistake, but know that we are forgiven. Know that we are forgiven. And then we need to brush off the dust of our failings and move forward with God. Do not allow your mistakes to hinder the work that you're doing with God. Don't allow the enemy to keep you in that place. Because he will. He'll be like, you see? Oh, you see, you screwed up again. There you go. Messed it up. Made a big boo-boo. Look at that. You're no good now, are you? Look, it's terrible. You're a big mess. See, you did it again. It's terrible. I'm telling you, man, if I did that, I'd be flogging myself with reeds in the back of Palmer's and that'd be it. You can't. You can't live like that. That's not how God wants us to live. It's not how God wants us to live. Don't allow the enemy's lies to allow you to miss out on all that God has for you. If you accept the enemy's lies, you miss out on God's restoration. You miss out on Jesus' salvation. Because then the enemy has a foothold and he's allowed to win. And he doesn't win. He hasn't won. He's never going to win. It's not like, you know, the vote's still undecided. He is not winning. He will never win. He can have a really good poke around and a really good go, and he can be very, very convincing. But he will not win. So don't allow our mistakes to hinder our progress with God. Leave that up there for a little minute. And that's it.